stuff. Yes, he does. We've got a timeout, and that's the last timeout for St. Bernard's. And the score, couldn't ask for a tighter game with 20 seconds left. 59-58. And let's see who's going to inbound the basketball. Down underneath with 14 seconds left for St. Bernard on the shot clock. Williams. Way out on top to Nunley. Nunley drives. Nunley dishes back. Chrisman. And that was Williams off balance. Put up by Hooker. Jeffrey Hooker. And that gives St. Bernard a 1-point lead. 60-59. In the air, no good. Outside left.
The 2000 team was special because those guys were like a family.
I think what made them special was that we had a diverse basketball team. And when they walked on the court, you saw a diverse group of young men that represented different cultures and different communities.
Cohesion, the family of the team. I mean, I can say when they first started, because, you know, being the bench coach, I would come to all the practice and be there, and I can see how they were gelling together.
And we had a lot of really good basketball players on that team that actually, you know, sacrificed parts of their game so that they can accomplish things that they did accomplish.
And they had a lot of talent, and that talent spread across all 12 players.
But with this team, I saw them sort of fall in the line and understand their roles as a team, and I think that worked for them very well.
I thought the team was going to be special. It was a couple of different times, okay? At first, it was in the summer. I ran into Michael Tabb. Then I said, geez, if you went to town, we win a state championship. You'd be the last piece that we need.
You know, we had a really good sense that when we had our first practice that there was a different level of talent on the court. We had three superstars, clearly. But at some point in time, it was going to be the other players, the role players, that had to make some plays because teams were literally going to figure out defenses to guard those three players. One of the things that we did in the preseason was play a really tough schedule. And one of those teams was Encina, who had beat our 1997 team in NorCal Finals.
We started with them, and they had a very, very good team.
Like, we were playing and just beating a team out, and like Ralph might have mentioned, when Ryan Scott got in the game, and he went down and stuffed the basketball with Thorthy.
And we beat Encina by 30.
We end up beating them by 30.
Because the team was supposed to be really good that we were playing.
And so that was really the moment that I thought this team could be special.
They were the boys and we were the men. And I said, if they're that supposed to be that good and we're cleaning their clock, we must be really good statewide.
So we had like a starting six, actually. And so what we had was four starters, and two of the players were so unique that we alternated which one we started. Brian DeFarge was obvious. He was our point guard. He was 6'4", incredible athlete, saw the floor.
Brian DeFarge, all MCAL, all Bay Area, all Northern California, ended up getting a Division I scholarship to Boise State.
Michael Tabb. Was a 6'7" forward, led the league in scoring from the outside shots. He could post up. He was all about the points.
Highlight that I remember him was we played Redwood High School. He had 16 points at halftime. All of them was dunks. Come third quarter, his legs was gone.
Jair Feldhaus obviously made challenges for everybody. He was 6'11". He had guard skills. He could post up. He could dribble the ball like a guard.
6'10" center. Ended up getting a Division I scholarship to Villanova.
Greg Smith was about 6'4", and he played for us as a sophomore. And then as a junior, and all of a sudden as a senior, he was the guy with almost all the experience in our system. And so he was the quiet person back there, a small forward doing all the dirty work.
Undersized, 6'3", 6'4", forward, probably one of our best defenders.
And then we had Mark and Jeremy.
Mark Wallace, he was a 6'2", shooting guard also, just a phenomenal athlete.
Incredible athletes. Mark was left-handed, had incredible range. Defensively, they were both the same player. They were all over people. They could go in the open court.
For two games, and I've never seen this, for two games, all Jeremy's shots that he put up, he did not hit the rim. They hit bottom of the net for two games straight.
And then David Chan was another one of our players who would have been a starter, came off the bench. And, you know, he scored 30 against Novato. Just tells you everything about his talent level.
And I remember the Novato game. He came off the bench and got 30 points in the Novato game.
Ahmed Papora, I remember Brian did not play against the first San Rafael game. And Ahmed had all the pressure on him. And Ahmed played an incredible game. And then literally off the bench, Ryan Scott was a solid 6'5", 6'6", power forward, who literally just played his role.
I can't not mention Ryan Scott. The St. Mary's game, it was a very tightly contested game. Brian broke down the defense, passed it to Ryan coming baseline. Brian went baseline and dunked so hard on whoever was there. I looked down, their coach went like this. At that point, I knew that game was over. The MCAL season was not a cakewalk at all.
It wasn't that it was difficult.
I wouldn't say a cakewalk.
We had some challenges. But we knew where the challenges were, and we prepared to meet those challenges, and those challenges help us down the line.
One game, and I recall, was when we played San Rafael. One of the guys off the bench, Ahmed Papera, ended up having to play point guard that game. One of the best games I've seen him play.
I saw the depth that we had on the bench, and I was saying, you know, it doesn't matter who goes down, we have another plug to plug in the hole.
Nobody's beating us, not in this league. But we had lost to Oakland Tech in the preseason, our only loss there, and they had like two NBA players. We'd know later who were two NBA players.
But the MCAL was not a cakewalk. You know, it was hard. Every game was hard.
You know, the MCAL was not a cakewalk because everybody was getting ready to play us. We played St. Bernard. Our biggest problem was we were playing at Sacramento, at the arena, and the three-point line was deeper. We struggled in the first half because our guys were shooting from the NBA three-point line. And whether it was them trying to prove they could make it from there or not realizing how far it was, we didn't have a really good first half. And so slowly, methodically, I think we took control. Staff started making some shots. You know, Brian got the ball inside, Jair was scoring, so we went up like 17. You know, I'm not sure when it was. Probably, I think it was like late third quarter. We established a 70-point lead. and St. Bernard's just didn't quit. They had some really good guards. They cut the lead down slowly but surely, and to the point where the last few minutes of the game, literally they took the lead. And so we talked about it at that timeout. Hey, if they score, if we don't score and they score, we're gonna run it quick and we're not calling a timeout. We took it out, everybody ran their lanes. We end up taking a shot from the corner, and Jair and Tab, you'll see the picture. They're both sitting there, ready to tip it in. Jair happened to be the one that tipped it in. You know, our team, the composure never left this basketball team. You know, in a game that started slow, we got a lead and we let a team back in. We just still knew we're the better team. I think our whole season kind of wrapped into that one game, all the things we went through. And then when I came back, Ralph's calling me about girls basketball. He said, come on, I don't coach girls basketball. You know, I've watched Tam's girls basketball.
You know, I said, hey, Mike, you know, the Tam girls position is about to open up. They got this player, that player. Actually, going to be pretty good.
So, you know, I came and agreed to coach girls basketball with him. And so we've been doing it for the last 8 years.
Only thing that, you know, I was an adjustment was trying to, as a coach, not being so intense and with the yelling.
And so with the girls is that they take everything personal. You know, where the guys, it rubs off their back.
Callie, you're half court. Yeah, Bella! Let's go, we're in it. Let's go, Maury, in defense. Oh, what? Stop ball, help, stop ball, back of Maury, stop ball. Rebound, push. Tap it.
Can you watch the hook, please?
No foul. Ain't no foul on that. All right, box out. Over the back. Good job, Megan. corner. No. Hey, but you got to keep going. She's not there, Maury. Push. It's your dribble.
It was just, that team was very special. And the way that this school community embraced them.
These ties. So I went out and brought everyone on the team one of these ties, and all the players had their name on their tie.
And I remember people from Marin City get on the bus and drive to Stockton to go watch us play Modesto Christian up there.
It's very rare where a public school wins a state competition in basketball. It's usually the private and the Catholic schools that wins everything.
A very special team, you know, that's gonna be forever tied, you know, with the state championship.